Penguin Random House Audio presents Good Strategy, Bad Strategy, The Difference and Why It Matters by Richard Rumelt. Read for you by Sean Runnette.
Introduction. Overwhelming Obstacles. In 1805, England had a problem. Napoleon had conquered big chunks of Europe and planned the invasion of England. But to cross the Channel, he needed to wrest control of the sea away from the English. Off the southwest coast of Spain, the French and Spanish combined fleet of 33 ships met the smaller British fleet of 27 ships. The well-developed tactics of the day were for the two opposing fleets to each stay in line, firing broadsides at each other. But British Admiral Lord Nelson had a strategic insight. He broke the British fleet into two columns and drove them at the Franco-Spanish fleet, hitting their line perpendicularly. The lead British ships took a great risk, but Nelson judged that the less trained Franco-Spanish gunners would not be able to compensate for the heavy swell that day. At the end of the Battle of Trafalgar, the French and Spanish lost 22 ships, two-thirds of their fleet. The British lost none. Nelson was mortally wounded, becoming, in death, Britain's greatest naval hero. Britain's naval dominance was ensured and remained unsurpassed for a century and a half. Nelson's challenge was that he was outnumbered. His strategy was to risk his lead ships in order to break the coherence of his enemy's fleet. With coherence lost, he judged, the more experienced English captains would come out on top in the ensuing melee. Good strategy almost always looks this simple and obvious, and does not take a thick deck of PowerPoint slides to explain. It does not pop out of some strategic management tool, matrix, chart, triangle, or fill-in-the-blank scheme. Instead, a talented leader identifies the one or two critical issues in the situation, the pivot points that can multiply the effectiveness of effort, and then focuses and concentrates action and resources on them. Despite the roar of voices wanting to equate strategy with ambition, leadership, vision, planning, or the economic logic of competition, strategy is none of these. The core of strategy work is always the same: discovering the critical factors in a situation and designing a way of coordinating and focusing actions to deal with those factors. A leader's most important responsibility is identifying the biggest challenges to forward progress and devising a coherent approach to overcoming them. In contexts ranging from corporate direction to national security, strategy matters. Yet we've become so accustomed to strategy as exhortation that we hardly blink an eye when a leader spouts slogans and announces high-sounding goals, calling the mixture a strategy. Here are four examples of this syndrome. The event was a strategy retreat. The CEO had modeled it on a similar event at British Airways he had attended several years before. About 200 upper-level managers from around the world gathered in a hotel ballroom where top management presented a vision for the future: to be the most respected and successful company in their field. There was a specially produced motion picture featuring the firm's products and services being used in colorful settings around the world. There was an address by the CEO accompanied by dramatic music to highlight the company's strategic goals: global leadership, growth, and high shareholder return. There were breakouts into smaller groups to allow discussion and buy-in. There was a colorful release of balloons. There was everything but strategy. As an invited guest, I was disappointed, but not surprised. A specialist in bonds, Lehman Brothers had been a pioneer in the new wave of mortgage-backed securities that buoyed Wall Street in the 2002 through 6 period. By 2006, signs of strain were appearing. U.S. home sales had peaked in mid-2005, and home price appreciation had stopped. A small increase in the Fed's interest rate had triggered an increase in foreclosures. Lehman CEO Richard Fuld's response, formalized in 2006, was a strategy of continuing to gain market share by growing faster than the rest of the industry. In the language of Wall Street, Lehman would do this by increasing its risk appetite. That is, it would take on the deals its competitors were rejecting. Operating with only 3% equity and much of its debt supplied on a very short-term basis, this policy should have been accompanied by clever ways of mitigating the increased risk. A good strategy recognizes the nature of the challenge and offers a way of surmounting it. Simply being ambitious is not a strategy. In 2008, Lehman Brothers ended its 158 years as an investment bank with a crash that sent the global financial system into a tailspin. Here, the consequences of bad strategy were disastrous for Lehman, the United States, and the world. In 2003, President George W. Bush authorized the U.S. military to invade and conquer Iraq. The invasion went quickly. Once the army-to-army fighting stopped, administration leaders had expected to oversee a rapid transition to a democratic civil society in Iraq. Instead, as a violent insurgency gathered momentum, individual units of the U.S. military fell back on running search-and-destroy missions out of secure bases, the same approach that had failed so badly in Vietnam. There were numerous high-sounding goals: freedom, democracy, reconstruction, security, but no coherent strategy for dealing with the insurgency. The change came in 2007. Having just written the Army Marine Corps Counterinsurgency Field Manual, General David Petraeus was sent to Iraq, along with five additional brigades of troops. But more than the extra soldiers, Petraeus was armed with an actual strategy. His idea was that one could combat an insurgency as long as the large preponderance of civilians supported a legitimate government. The trick was to shift the military's focus from making patrols to protecting the populace. A populace that was not in fear of insurgent retaliation would provide the information necessary to isolate and combat the insurgent minority. This change, replacing amorphous goals with a true problem-solving strategy, made an enormous difference in the results achieved. In November 2006, I attended a short conference about Web 2.0 businesses. The term Web 2.0 purportedly referred to a new approach to web services, but none of the technologies involved was really new. The term was actually a code word for Google, MySpace, YouTube, Facebook, and various other new web-based businesses that had suddenly become very valuable. At lunch, I found myself seated with seven other attendees at a round table. Someone asked me what I do. I briefly explained that I was a faculty member at UCLA where I taught and did research on strategy, and that I was a consultant on the subject to a variety of organizations. The CEO of a web services company was sitting directly across from me. He put down his fork and said, "Strategy is never quitting until you win." I could not have disagreed more, but I was not there to argue or lecture. "Winning is better than losing," I said, and the conversation turned to other matters. The key insight driving this book is the hard-won lesson of a lifetime of experience at strategy work. As a consultant to organizations, as a personal advisor, as a teacher, and as a researcher. A good strategy does more than urge us forward toward a goal or vision. A good strategy honestly acknowledges the challenges being faced and provides an approach to overcoming them. And the greater the challenge, the more a good strategy focuses and coordinates efforts to achieve a powerful competitive punch or problem-solving effect. Unfortunately, good strategy is the exception, not the rule. And the problem is growing. More and more organizational leaders say they have a strategy, but they do not. Instead, they espouse what I call bad strategy. Bad strategy tends to skip over pesky details such as problems. It ignores the power of choice and focus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.